So good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone, wherever you are in the world. Just preparing to start the webinar for today. We just wait a minute or so for a few more people to join us. As you can see from the title, the webinar will be focused today on supplier risk assessment and trying to give some case studies and examples of how we can use technology to make that a better process. There's a QR code on there you can use to make the session interactive. So please use your mobile phone cameras to scan and use that to participate in the polls and also to give feedback and download any tools that we offer during the webinar. I think at that point, I think we'll start the session. So my name's Neil Marshall, ex-Coca-Cola for 20 plus years, too many years to remember for myself. For the last year, I've been working as a consultant for my own company, working with select partners across the globe, mainly in Europe and the US. And I'm delighted to say I also have my friend, colleague, and the CTO and founding partner at Agroknow, Giannis, Stoitsis, who will also take us through this webinar and give some case study examples and do a bit of a live demo. Towards the end, we'll also do some interaction, if possible, and if there's time, to do some question and answers as we get to the end. For a bit more about Giannis, as well as being the Chief Technology Officer and partner, he has over 15 years experience working in this field, particularly around risk monitoring assessment, using AI and data intelligence to help build technology solutions to support food manufacturers, retailers, food service operators, et cetera, to try and improve their insights into the business and prevent issues occurring. He leads the team responsible for the Food Archive platform, which is available through links, but it's also www.agroknow.com/foodarchive. You can also find that, I'm sure, if you search for it, which is the premium food risk technology platform for the industry. Eponymo, which is my bad attempt at Greek to mean next slide. So we're being ably assisted by a couple of people in the background. So our goal for today and the webinar is to focus on how technology can help us really look at the supplier risk rankings. How can we use that to assess our suppliers, to minimize the recalls, and use some of that data that's out there everywhere to try and focus in and hone in on managing those suppliers and assessing their performance. We know there's so much data out there these days, it's difficult to select which data to use, and you're limited, particularly with the pandemic and COVID, for access to that data and information. So technology is an obvious answer to support your teams and support that process to evaluate suppliers. So let's make that decision and just start today. So yes, next slide. So some of the background information, I think people have seen that before. Just go back one, yes, sorry. There is a continued background of noise in the industry. What do people trust or not? You know, people have probably seen this information before, this slide, we've used it in previous webinars. And it's scary to believe that, you know, these are the three main sources where people get their information around food safety, particularly for consumers, from the internet, Google searching and scanning, etc., from the food companies, but also they rely heavily on the data from the governments and the regulators. And that one, the governments and the regulators are generally the most trusted for the consumer. But transitioning also across into the audit space, most big companies now have had to move to, and smaller companies, have had to move to the use of remote audits. So remote audits to replace physical assessments, where people have had to rely again on technology to make those assessments of the suppliers using Google Glasses and other solutions to look inside the supplier's operation, to assess those risks, look at the documents, share it, and in some ways it's made it more effective and more efficient. Because obviously there's a time saving from people traveling, there's a cost saving from people not having to fly and drive around visiting suppliers. But sometimes the data can't be as easily accessible, or in some cases, there's a lack of trust around that data. So using technology again, remote audits have been a good way to gain insights, particularly in the pandemic and beyond, I'm sure it'll stay, for getting insights into suppliers' performance. But we can also use that data to feed into our supplier risk models. So Agroknow, please, next slide. So some of that data and risk ranking means that there's trust in the food safety data. It's time consuming for companies, people's quality teams to look through that data, looking at the new suppliers, evaluating that historical data. And there's a need to make a quicker, simpler way of accessing that data, because it's often time consuming. It takes a lot of time to access the data. It's a lot of time to then correlate the data, analyze, review the data. And often a lot of companies are still using manual systems and Excel sheets to review that data and consolidate between systems that they use in their companies. And this can lead to errors. People can make mistakes, and it's not effective. It's not a good process, and it's not efficient to do it that way. Next slide, please. So what are we going to try to do today is look at how you use your process and offer some solutions through some examples that Giannis will show, but also then show you the Food Archive platform and how it can help you automate your process. So for you now and the people on the call and the people who will listen in later, how automated is your process? How often do you update it? How do you make sure you get an early warning or indication of any change, particularly from the suppliers? And if I think about my career and going back over 20, 30 years, most of the issues and recalls have occurred when it's been from a supplier. And sometimes a supplier, I would call it the tier two supplier. So the supplier to the supplier. So they make a change in their process, they change an ingredient, they change a manufacturing process, which has a knock-on implication for the tier one supplier, and then leading into the manufacturer or the retailer later, because they've changed something that you weren't aware of. So that's something else that needs to be captured when you're assessing the risks from your suppliers. And next slide, please. So we now want to transition into a poll to try to make this as interactive as we can. And these are the four questions that are now coming up. If you can please answer, we'll give it a minute or so to capture the results, and then we'll transition through to the next slide. I think one of the things that, just while you're filling in, one of the things that people have noticed is the amount of data that's out there. It's difficult. There's a lot of data. So how do you keep that simple, easy, and effective, and how do you manage that data? Okay, there we go. So the results are in. We have manual updating of Excel documents being the biggest one, probably no surprise. The second biggest one, some people are already using a third-party software to try to automate their processes. And then a tie between lack of systems and using in-house software. I think that's probably fairly reflective of what we've seen so far. I'm sure Giannis can comment as well further in the presentation, but that's probably no surprise to me. And next slide, please. So transitioning now to some case studies and over to Giannis to take us forward for the next section. Thank you, Giannis.
Thank you, Neil. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all. Thank you very much for your interest in this webinar. So I'm Giannis Stoitsis. I'm with Agroknow. So if we can go to the next slide. In Agroknow, our mission is to empower the people, ensuring that everyone has access to safe and healthy food. This mission is that keeps us excited every morning that we wake up, because we are helping and supporting people that are doing such important work, that are responsible to keep the food safe for all of us, including ourselves and our families. When people are asking us when and how companies turn to FoodAkai, turn to Agroknow, sorry, in order to use a platform like FoodAkai, the answer is that this happens when the companies have to deal with a large amount of data that they have, or external data that they need to manage and to have at their fingertips, because they want to prioritize risk mitigation measures, and they need to be early informed about external risks that may affect their suppliers. So this is how a collaboration with food companies starts for us. And we work in the area that we call food risk intelligence. And in this area, we have identified three key pillars for risk prevention. And these are the pillars in which we are trying to help the companies. The one pillar has to do with the risk monitoring, and we are helping food companies in the scanning, investigating, in the reporting incidents that are announced globally, and that they are very relevant for the supply chain. The second pillar is the risk assessment, and this has to do with calculating risk indicators for thousands of ingredients and suppliers using different data types, which is one of the challenges that we have also mentioned in the first part, that Neil mentioned in the first part of this webinar. And the third pillar is the risk prevention, is how we can prioritize risk mitigation actions. Mitigation actions like the lab testing program, the supplier audits program, and how we can prioritize them and make them to focus on the high-risk areas in order to help us to prevent incidents and help the companies to prevent incidents. In the next slide, please. And working with many companies and hundreds of food safety experts, we have identified that in these three pillars, there are three categories of people, three categories of companies, that are the ones that are a bit skeptical about adopting a digital solution. And they are right, because they feel very well with the current tools and the current practices that they are using. There are others that they are following the trends in these three pillars. They have started using digital tools, or they have they are using a third-party solution for that. And we have also the ones that they want to be the first in adopting the digital solution, that believe very much that a digital solution for risk prevention can improve and can transform, of course, to a better direction, the current practices for risk prevention. And based on the data that we have, speaking to so many people, the current status of the industry in these three areas and in these three categories is that in the risk monitoring pillar, we see that the people has already, and the companies have already adopted a solution, or they are doing this even manually, but with the help of some of the tools. in the risk assessment, there are a lot of mainly Excel-based tools that are used. They are also, the companies are also adopting digital solutions in this area, in the risk assessment area. And in the third pillar, the risk prevention pillar, mainly the companies are changing the preventive measures only when there is a major issue announced. There are no tools used right now by the industry and by the most companies, and of course there are no solutions that are developed internally in order to prevent and to predict risk. Next slide, please. So, Neil, we want the input of the people here again.
It's very interesting what you're just putting forward there, Giannis, particularly the three areas. And I think it's, you know, if you reflect back on people we speak to and where they are, I don't think anyone will say they're really far to the right on everything. I think that's probably unlikely. But it would be good to see where our audience stands today. So if you can also scan the QR code again with your phone and give us the feedback. There's also an opportunity to download the tool as well that's been provided by Agroknow from this solution. So I think everybody wants to be a leader, but I think people are somewhere between the three boxes. They may be leading in one area, but they're down to the left in the others. You know, I can only speak from my own experience. It'd be great to be always on the right. And I think the other thing to mention here is, you know, with the platform that you're developing and developed to this point, everything's connected into this tool. So this is why it's really useful for doing the risk assessment. You have the hazards connected in, you have the ingredient assessments, the supplier information, which helps you get a really connected picture for the risk assessment. I think that's critical as well. Right, I think you're going to take us through some use cases now, Giannis.
Thank you. So the what we will try to do here in this part of the webinar is that we will focus on one very important case, on how we can perform a risk ranking, supplier risk ranking, something that is widely done as a practice in the industry by estimating the risk score for its supplier using different parameters. And we have two, actually, there are two sub-cases. The one case is that we may want to start working with a new supplier, and this happens a lot, as also Neil mentioned, during the pandemic period, because due to the issues with availability of the materials, there is a need to change a supplier, so you need to engage a new supplier, and there we what specifically a manufacturer needs to do is that he needs to check the history of the supplier regarding food safety incidents, like which are the food recalls and border rejections linked to the specific company, but also which are the inspections and the outcomes of these inspections that have been done by the authorities and have been reported on the by the authorities on their website in different globally in different regions. So how may I know about all these issues, about the incidents and the inspections? And this is actually something that is also required by the latest food safety regulation and also by food safety standards. So knowing which is the food safety history of a company that you are about to work with is a very important step in the evaluation. And the other subcase and the other cases, if we go to the next slide, is that also for the existing suppliers that the manufacturer, that the food company has, needs to identify which of the suppliers is potentially at high risk. So this requires, in the next slide, we are making this more specific. So this requires to be able to identify which suppliers may potentially be at risk because one of the materials or the ingredients that they are using is affected by an emerging risk. And this also means that managing the risk, you want also to be aligned with the suppliers and ensure that they have the mitigation measures in place, that they have put the mitigation measures in place. And the second thing that is very important is to be able to identify which are the challenges for the suppliers and to collaborate with them in order to adopt a more proactive approach. And discussing with companies, we see that this builds visibility and transparency in the collaboration with suppliers, because you know, as a buyer or as a, in this collaboration or as a supplier, you know which are the challenges you need to deal with and to address. And since this is an open thing and this is transparent, we can collaborate and we can make sure that these challenges, this emerging risk, will be addressed through a very good mitigation plan. So this is the current status, and now it's very important to see how AI, but also data, can help into automate these kind of processes to address these challenges of managing different types of information that you may have internally, but also information that you need to collect from external sources about the risks. We will present these three through use cases for these three, for these two use cases that we mentioned. The one on how you can evaluate a new supplier, and the other on how you can identify which suppliers are at high risk because they are affected by an emerging issue in the supply chain. So starting with the case of evaluating new supplier, a digital solution like Kudaka, if we go to the next slide, is collecting all the information about the food safety incidents, either these are recalls, border rejections, import refusals, announced in different regions, and provides you the ability to perform a very good and a very accurate search and to find out for a specific supplier if historically there are incidents or inspections or warning letters that have been announced for this specific supplier. And this can be done only through a search. And the real cases here from the discussions that we have with companies, they are saying to us that although we have very good search engines, global search engines, the reality is that in some cases, this information is hidden behind Excel files or scanned documents or web pages in different languages. So still, it's a true story that they are searching for a specific company in the global searches, in the global web search engines, and they are saying to us that there's nothing for this company. Can we try to do it also in a good search engine specifically for the suppliers that you have in Fudakai? And when we do that, they are surprised because there are many things that have been reported by the national authorities, but they are not visible to the global search engines that are out there. And if we go to the next slide, after searching and finding all the issues that have been reported, the digital solution can consolidate this in a live risk profile, where you have the option to see all the incidents, not only for the company, but also for subsidiaries or for specific facilities of the company. So this is consolidated. And in some cases, you may still want to be very specific and go to a specific subsidiary and not the parent organization. So this is also feasible. You can study which were the inspections results, the inspection outcomes. And based on all the frequency and the severity of the incidents that have been reported for the origin of the supplier, you can have also a risk for the specific region. So in this way, only with a simple search in the digital solution, in a solution like Kudakai, and by getting such a supplier risk profile, you may have all the food safety history and the regulatory history of this company at your hands, with no manual work on searching on the web in order to find specific incidents in different websites, in different locations, in different regions. If we go to the part of how we can identify which suppliers are at high risk, then the digital solution like Kudakai can help, first of all, through the very good risk monitoring approach and module that it provides. So in the next slide, if we go to a specific use case of a manufacturing of products, if we assume that we have a manufacturer of bakery products, a ready-to-eat products, then using a very good monitoring service, the manufacturer can get an early notification, like we are showing here, about an increasing risk with a specific percentage of increase for a chemical like, for instance, the ETO. And since he has this early notification, he can go and study this in depth. So he can go to the supplier dashboard, where all the suppliers, that all the companies that he's working with are listed. And for each company, he can see which is the level of the risk, either in a numerical way, like we are showing here, or there is also a visual heat map that can present to the manufacturer, and he can identify which are the suppliers that are at a high, medium, or low risk. So in the specific case, he will see that the main supplier for his sesame seeds, the supplier A in this case, has an increased ingredient risks, and he needs to investigate this further. So this means, if we go to the next slide, this means that first of all, he can see this also, there is a heat map that highlights which are the suppliers that you need to pay attention, because they have they are in a high risk region based on the ingredients and the incidents that have been reported for this supplier. And if we go to the next slide, we can see that based on different drivers of the risk, we can have an overall score for the specific company and for all the companies. And using this overall score, we can rank these companies from the ones with the highest risk score to the lowest. So in this way, we can design very important mitigation measures, like, for instance, to ask for certificates of analysis for the specific ingredient that the supplier is managing or is producing, or we can use also additional parameters like the recalls that this company had, the border rejections, the inspections, the warning letters. And using all these parameters, we can have an overall score for the companies. And what we hear also from the companies is that, yes, in this case, we would like also to adjust, if we go to the next slide, that the companies are asking us if they can also adjust the different parameters, the weight of the different parameters in the overall score. So there is also the possibility in the solution to adjust the parameters, so to give different weight or to disable completely some of these risk weights and focus only on the ones that are according to your risk assessment model for suppliers. And it's also very important that if a company, if a manufacturer would like to include one new and additional parameter, like for instance, the audit score, he can do it by including the parameter and by attaching also, by uploading the data for this parameter. So if we have the risk score for the companies for which I want to perform the risk ranking, this will be added as a new column here, as a new parameter, and can be used in the risk ranking of these companies. And in this way, we can identify very easily which are the companies that are at high risk. And this is an automated process because any new incident, any new inspection is automatically collected in this risk assessment approach, in this matrix, and is used to recalculate the risk. So if there are many new incidents reported for the ingredient of a specific supplier, this will increase the risk of the ingredients, and this will be automatically reflected in this dashboard, in this risk matrix. Next slide, please. So, Neil, now that you see this, the approach that a manufacturer can follow using a digital solution, which do you believe that are the benefits for the manufacturer?
Before I get to the benefits, I just want to just re-emphasize, I guess, some of the points you just made, Jens. I think people need to understand really through the platform, you can pull out hidden data that's on the internet, in the reporting by the regulators, you're gathering that information. I think the search engine within FoodAKI helps that a lot, particularly to give you a really good picture around the supplier. And it helps you to connect all that data, as you just explained, into one place. But it also allows you to make a bespoke system that suits your individual company. So the platform around this risk assessment is still flexible enough to add in, like you just mentioned, the supplier audit or the individual data as well, to that feed into the platform. I think that also makes the platform unique. And it's really, really very flexible. That's extra items in addition to the benefits we're seeing, or we're just going to mention, because that global perspective to be able to find trends, look for trends, connect it to the horizon scanning, the other way we connect. And again, as we talk about many times, trying to look forward to predict or give us insights for what future trends could be, that's also really important. And I think the whole piece around managing your suppliers, looking at the risks from the suppliers, and managing what potentially problems they can cause you, allows you to mitigate against that in advance. And the critical piece that's still not going away, that's still important for everyone, is that visibility back up your supply chain to look at your suppliers. I mentioned earlier about big pain in the neck for me always was around tier two and even tier three suppliers. So you're not always talking about just the first level supplier to you as a manufacturer or a user. It can be two and three steps backwards as well. So it could be IP or confidential to that supplier you're buying from. But how do you get the insights into those suppliers beyond that as well. And I know we've talked about, Giannis, how you can use the platform to do that as well. Getting insights, not only on your direct supplier, but the ones beyond that, because that's usually where the issues come from. And that all points around personalizing the alerts through the platform around changes to suppliers. If there's a recall with that specific supplier and you've got it in your profile in the platform, it will give you an alert. I think they're really important benefits for people to use the platform and realize how it can help them to automate and make it easier in their day-to-day operation. I think with that, we're going to step forward because I don't want to talk too much and take too much of the time, but move forward to the demo because I know me and you can talk about this forever, but let's try and look at a bit of the live demo.
Yeah, but your point is very valid and very important, especially the thing about the tier one and tier two suppliers. That's why with the companies that we are working together, we are always suggesting of involving also suppliers, tier one suppliers in the platform, because in this way they will make sure that also tier two suppliers will be monitored. Or if you have a very good traceability information, then you can directly as a company include both tier one but also tier two. So now I will focus more. We have covered very important things about the supplier assessment, the supplier ranking, the monitoring of the suppliers. Now I will focus more on how, and I will share my screen so I hope that everyone can see my screen. On how we can monitor the ingredients and we can assess the risk of the ingredients, and we can even prevent and we can predict incidents and risk of the ingredients. So how we can leverage all this data and the AI technology in order to automate also this process of risk monitoring, risk assessment and risk prevention at the level of ingredients. So suppose that you have a supplier that is providing to you turmeric powder, for instance, curcuma. So how such platform can help you also at this level, at the level of the ingredient that this supplier has, and the supplier is providing to you, is managing. And we want to go very deep in the supply chain. We don't want only to be at the tier one. We want to go on tier two and even at the raw material part. So in this case, the platform will help us because, first of all, it gives you all this power of risk monitoring, the dynamic risk monitoring. So for the ingredients monitoring, in the case of a specific ingredient like ground turmeric, it will highlight to us that there is a very important increasing trend for ground turmeric, that if we compare the last year issues with the current year issues, there's a huge increase, and directly we can go and perform a hazard analysis for this specific ingredient, and we can identify which were the cause, which was the root cause of this highly increasing trend. Yeah? So you can do that very easily in such a platform. You just click on the specific ingredient and you can see all the data, also organized very well in the different types of hazards. So for instance, we can see that during the last 12 months, there is a very big, important increase of incidents. And there are mainly incidents for turmeric powder coming from India, that originated from India. And the main reason of this, the main reasons for this increasing trend are two, are the chemicals that were found in the turmeric powder, and also fraud cases, and specifically maybe adulteration cases. So if you click, because we have the information very well organized and it's very accurate and is curated by also food safety experts, you can be very you can go very deep and you can drill down to specific hazards. So for instance, we see here that the main issue is the presence of pesticides that are exceeding the limits. And if you click on the pesticides, you can see that the main reason was the use of ETO in curcuma. So it was not only the sesame seeds that was affected by the ETO, but there are several and many other ingredients that have been affected. And you can see also other chemicals that were found in turmeric powder during the last 2 years. And if you click on the risk on the list, you can see specifically which are these incidents and go and study details about this specific incident. And the same you can do for other types of hazards, like if I want to see what was the problem, what was the fraudulent practices that were identified. This has to do mainly with with the use of unauthorized ingredients and with adulteration cases. And if you click, for instance, on adulteration cases, you can go deeply and you can see that this has to do with addition of some enhancers and neutralizers, and you can be even, and you can see specifically what this was, what this happened, and which were the cases. So knowing which are the specific hazards is very important, because you know if the mitigation measures that you have in place are enough in order to prevent an incident. So if there is a large increase of incidents and a trend for ETO, or if there is a new risk, an emerging risk, you want to know it and you want to include this as a parameter in your lab testing, and also ask for the specific certificate of analysis from the supplier. And you can extend this analysis also in the risk assessment part. So you can perform a risk ranking for all the hazards that have been reported for ground turmeric. So you can see here that biological issue like Salmonella is one of the highest risks in turmeric, ground turmeric. There are also cases with lead that are frequent and there are ranked high. And there are also new issues, like, for instance, the ETO that we have already discussed, that are highlighted in this risk assessment as a new issue. So you may know which are the increasing, but also the emerging issues. And of course, if you want to make this very specific only to chemical issues, to have the risk ranking only to chemical for chemical issues, you can select only the chemical parameters and have this risk assessment only for chemical parameters. One of the very important questions that we get also from the companies that we are working together is that since we have all this information for the incidents that go historically back many years, and we know about their frequency, why we cannot apply predictive analytics technology in order to predict which will be the trend of the incidents within the next 12 months, or which will be the hazards that are likely to increase, which are the emerging issues, which will be the emerging issues in the next few months. This is something like, for instance, the weather prediction that you're getting every day. So how we can know which will be the trend of the incidents for a specific ingredient. So for this reason, we have applied AI technology, and we have built prediction models specifically for each ingredient, taking into consideration all the incidents that have been reported for this ingredient so far. And using this information, this data, we are forecasting, we are creating a forecast of the incidents, but also of the specific hazard. So in the case, for instance, of the ground turmeric, we see that based on the prediction, on the results of the prediction model, there will be there is not expected a very important increase of the incidents in the number of the incidents. And there are some countries that it seems that will have more incidents, but still there are some hazards that are likely to increase for the ground turmeric. Like for instance, Salmonella will have an increasing trend and also will have issue with heavy metals like lead that seems to be increasing. And based on the analysis of the past, we are also highlighting here which are the emerging hazards that are present, that may be present in the ground turmeric, in curcuma. And you can see that, for instance, there are cases with Sudan 1, with a color like tartrazine. So you may be you may want to include these parameters, to include this kind of emerging risks in your preventive measures, so to make sure that you have all the measures in place in order to prevent an incident, or to make sure that you have the materials and the ingredients that are authentic, that are very safe, and that you are getting what you have been promised to get. And also using the information about the predicted incidents and the hazards, we may have also a heat map of the risks that we have right now, so the actual heat map of the risk, but also the predicted heat map of the risk, so how the risk heat map will change within the next few months. And the system, knowing which are the suppliers from which you are getting the curcuma, or which are using in the product that they are providing to you the curcuma, you may be notified, and you may know which is specifically the supplier, this supplier, and why this supplier is at a higher risk. So we talked about how the digital solution that uses data and AI technology can transform the way that you are performing the supplier risk ranking. And also we go deeper here in how such a technology can be used also to go deep in the analysis of all the hazards and all the risks for a specific ingredient, and also how knowing all these emerging risks for the specific ingredient, you know which supplier or which suppliers are affected. So with that, I will go back to Neil.
Thank you, Giannis. Very interesting. I think the whole thing there, hopefully it comes across from your demonstration there, is that flexibility. You know, you were showing us easily how you jump around in the platform. But I think for some of the people on the call and people listening in, you know, they would have that ability if they also subscribe to the platform. They can also go in there and move around like you did. It's not just because you're a super user, an expert. People, you can go in there and customize it to your own needs and do that search. You know, that's important, I think, to know. I think from the business value angle, we've been through some examples there from the case studies and also through your demo, which really trying to help you to save time for yourself. Everyone's so busy these days. No one's got time to do anything. We've got less resources, less budget, less time. So automating a process, making it consistent, really assessing your suppliers and having those insights feeding into the platform makes it much easier to do that supplier risk assessment. I think the second point is around optimization, trying to optimize your current programs, your audits, your data, your information. So it again feeds into one solution. I think that's really important. And then the thing that we just touched on there about trying to do prediction. to prevent incidents occurring. I mean, the last thing you want is an issue or a recall or a foodborne illness from your company, but this is trying to help you be proactive to prepare and try and prevent that from happening. So you're not doing the 5 o'clock on a Friday and a weekend trying to resolve the issue. And the whole thing about automating the process means it takes away some of that manual effort, particularly if you've lost people or you're struggling to hire people in the current climate. We know that's difficulty for many people in many countries where resources and people are not so available. By automating away from a manual system of collecting that data and processing, it means you'll have a better, more robust system in place for assessing your suppliers. So flexibility and personalization with Food Archive help tremendously. I think next slide, please. Going on to the maps to show where you can go and give you some indication. I think Giannis talked several times about where people are and where you think your company is on that journey from skeptic to leader. And we mentioned earlier, it was a QR code and a tool which we'll provide now. So again, apologies, I saw somebody said they're on the phone and they can't scan, but I'm sure the team will share the information later. But there is a free tool there to help you assess where you are in your own personal and company digital journey. And you can use that to give an assessment and follow up back to the customer success team at Agroknow, who can help you and follow up with a more detailed discussion and webinar discussion demo if needed. Okay, next slide, please. I think we're gonna now try to go to, or maybe we'll leave that slide on. We're gonna try to go through some of the questions that we've received. Yeah, so I'm gonna be putting the hard questions to you.
Yeah.
As usual. So let me just try and scan through the questions. Let's see. I don't know if there's any that you already want to talk about.
Yeah. I have already studied the questions and they are beautiful and very interesting. So I will start answering them live, but also Neil, feel free to jump in and to complement.
Sure. Well, let's just go from the top.
I will start with the question about new companies or suppliers of novel ingredients. We rely on the information that is announced out there. So this is a limitation. Yeah, this is true. So if there is a very new company or if a company has changed brand and there is no connection to the previous company, then we will not have historical information for this company. So this is true. Novel ingredients, of course, they are monitored continuously. But limited data will be there for the very new companies. Usually, the very important suppliers of the industry are also getting inside the novel ingredients space. So at least we can have a very good food safety history of these companies, and we can have a good idea of the food safety culture of this company. This is very important. This is what we are discussing with many of the companies that we are working with. It's not only important to know the very specific thing that was reported for the company, but the profile of the company gives a very good idea of the food safety culture of the company.
Yeah, and I think that you already mentioned it. We've been through examples with some clients, customers, where the names are sometimes different and it's not always easy to identify the suppliers. But, like everything, you've got to work with that and identify the information and feed it in, because it's only as good as the data that's provided. I think that's the critical piece. I think there's another question about the trade supplier in Greece.
The traceability, this is a well-known problem. So thank you very much, Julia, for pointing this out. There is a lack of traceability of information in several cases. That's why what we are always suggesting to the companies that we are working with is to add all the ingredients and all the materials that are used in the products, even if you don't know the specific supplier, the tier one supplier, because you are mentioning, you are referring to this very critical thing that Neil mentioned. Even if you don't know it, please do not close your eyes to the emerging issues of specific ingredients and materials. You cannot close your eyes in an emerging issue for a spice. Even if this comes from, finally, not from India, but it comes from Egypt, for instance. You need to know about it, because in many cases, they are transferred through Egypt, but they are originally produced in India. So it's we are always suggesting of tracing and monitoring all the ingredients. A very good point about the correlation between kill step, like for salmonella, like the use of a chemical, and the salmonella. So what we have identified and what we have observed is that there is a very good correlation with a latency, of course, that first in the sesame seed, we had an increasing trend of salmonella, continuous increasing trend. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, this trend stopped because they started to use a chemical to stop this trend, because this was reported very much by the companies. And now that they stopped, it seems that the salmonella is going up again for some of the seeds and spices. So this is very true. This is a very good point. And yes, we have identified such a correlation, such this kind of causality.
Okay, that's the question from John Carter. Yeah, but there's another one about how can suppliers be assessed in the tool from abroad? I guess we've already covered that one. Suppliers are covered from all countries and all locations. Yeah, so there's no specific border just to Greece or just to Europe. Globally, suppliers can be included.
Yeah, of course, of course. There is no limitation. And it makes sense to include global because we are not scanning only the developed regions. We are also scanning the border rejections where many companies from other regions, like from Asia, from Africa, they have been reported during the border controls. So we are not focusing. You can find companies from everywhere. The database. In terms of publishing information, the authorities are in some. They are not in all regions. They are mainly in some regions. But we have a good coverage of the origin of the suppliers. A very good one.
Yeah, and like you say, if it's not reported in the country of origin, one of the other countries, probably in Europe or US or in Asia, will probably pick it up. That's the way to look at it.
Exactly.
I think there's a question, I know we're running out of time, but there's a question about is there an Excel or in-house tool that contains data for suppliers can be used to feed in the customized section and be included in the tool? So basically, can you add in individual company data, Giannis? I think we mentioned that already, but you just want to confirm that?
Is the possibility of importing all the suppliers list that you may have with their ingredients, all these things into the risk matrix that I presented, and automatically the risk will be estimated. So there is the possibility of importing an Excel file. And also in many places of the platform, there is a possibility of exporting the risk results and exporting all these risk estimations in Excel file. So you can continue and you can integrate it also in other processes.
Yeah, and that just made me think of another point. Obviously, within the platform, there's the whole reporting process as well, where you can export for reports and gather data and share it then within your own people who don't necessarily have access to the food archive, but you can share it in your own business. And I always found that a very, very useful way of sharing data around those risks as well. I know we're over time.
Yeah, we are.
Is there anything else that you want to, any other question?
We will also answer some of the questions that we did not manage to discuss. We will also answer it through email later. But I would like to thank you again for your interest in this webinar and for your attention. It was a pleasure, as always, to share experiences and our thoughts about it.
Yeah, and the same for me. So thank you to everybody who's joined today. Hope that was useful and insightful. The recording and the materials will be available, and the customer success team will share that. Please remember to use the QR code where you can to download the free tool. And thanks again for your time today. Thank you.